He's doing wrestling videos. Oh no, how unpopular, how distasteful, how childish. And I am a 33-year-old child. Let me live my childhood in my 30s. It won't hurt anyone. If you don't like it, skip the video. Don't dislike it. Give it a thumbs up and skip it. There, that helps me, helps you. And the next day, there'll be something up there you will enjoy. So this week, I've got something different, as I said. Oh, by the way, if you missed my video yesterday, check it out. Christmas chocolates, way! Get ready for Christmas early. If you haven't watched my video, you'll also not know that I am planning a 12 days of Christmas series on here, where we will be covering Christmas from the 1st of December. Every 2 days, a different themed Christmas video. And there will be a football Christmas themed video in there as well. But this week, I'm going to be doing ASMR according to Karl Pilkington. We have three of his books here. Karl Pilkington, if you don't know who he is, you should do. Where have you been? You've been hiding under a rock all these years. That there is Karl Pilkington. And one of the days this week, I'm going to read you some of the quotes and thoughts of Karl Pilkington, which I think will make a few of you laugh. They certainly make me laugh anyway. So we'll get on to that later on in the week. I'm also going to be doing a ASMR tag video. So let's get on to this real quickly, okay? The way it works is people who are in the in crowd of ASMR content creators send each other a tag. They tag each other in on a video. It's called the ASMR tag. It's 25 questions. You make a video and you answer these questions in your video. I'm not in the in crowd, so I've not been tagged in by anyone. I don't think I have any really ASMR creators that follow me. Maybe one or two, maybe a couple, I don't know. I think the majority of you are just watchers, which is great. I don't mind that in the slightest. I just don't think I conform to what an ASMR creator is expected to make. Like, you don't do football videos. Oh, no, 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 no. Wrestling? ASMR wrestling? Is he off his tiny brain? Yes, I am. Thank you. So, I don't think I really conform to what is expected. I just do what I enjoy. And if they don't like it, then guess what? I don't care. So in that respect, I mean, you all know yourselves, I do proper ASMR every once in a while. I used to with the chocolates. You know, like general, nice sounding videos. And other times I do rants. I don't really care, either way. But nobody has tagged me in on that video, so I've tagged myself in. Yes, I have. Kev at Whisper Corner, I've borrowed his questions because he put them in his description. He's done a great video on it. I've borrowed his questions. I've copied and pasted them. And I'm going to do my video this week. The ASMR tag video. So, after what has been a pretty much of a disaster of a weekend for me in terms of football, my club, Man United, losing to Man City 3-1 away. Not nice to see. It's never nice to see a club lose to their biggest rivals. My local club, Wolves, Wolverhampton, they got a great result at Arsenal. A 1-0 draw at Arsenal. They got a draw at Old Trafford. The Wolves are doing great away from home in these big games. It's a shame that they lost 2 points yesterday against Arsenal, with Mkhitaryan getting the equaliser, but still a good result. Barcelona lost 4-3 to Real Betis. Wow, that's a crazy result. We're going to go into all the results in a little bit. But my feature today, before I get into the feature, sorry, somebody messaged me on here last night, commented on my video about my best 11. It said, can you do an MLS team? Yes, I will. If you're watching now, I'll be doing that on Friday. I won't make a big thing about it. I'll just give you my best 11. It'll be players who have either played in the MLS or who are American and I know them have played in the Premier League. I've got to be honest, I don't know like a top goalkeeper playing over in the MLS. So I'll use an American keeper from the Premier League, whether that be Brad Friedel, Casey Keller, Tim Howard. I'll do it that way. But we'll have a mix of MLS players and American players. my best 11. Ooh, it's going to be tough. David Villa or Ibrahimovic. Lampard or Gerrard or Pirlo. Ooh, Rooney as well. You've got Beckham. There've been some really good players over there. George Best back in the day. You can include George Best in that. Who else went over there? I think Sam Allardyce had a period in America. He won't make it in now. Pelé. So, yeah, we'll get into that at some point during, on Friday. But today, after watching that game yesterday, the United game, I was quite frustrated, obviously, as a United fan. But at the same time, I'm hearing a lot. I heard a conversation on the radio the other day on Talk Sport earlier on in the week, which is a British radio station, and all they do is talk about football and sports all day, every day. It's great. And the conversation came up, is Pep Guardiola better, or will he be better than Sir Alex Ferguson? Somebody said if he wins another couple of Premier League titles like this one and the next one, he's going to be better. How? That's what all I want to ask, is how is he going to be better? Okay. Alex Ferguson. We're going to get into my reasons, my argument here in a moment, but the man is a legend. Go back to when Fergie did that in the 90s. The man won the treble, a Champions League, a Premier League and an FA Cup in the same season. He had Arsenal breathing down his neck with the best Arsenal team I've ever seen, with Henri, Vieira, Overmars, Petit, Bergkamp, great players. He had Wenger at the top of his game. What's Man City got to compete with right now? Jose Mourinho, who doesn't know how to put a team together. A bunch of misfits at Man United. Average players in defence. Average players in midfield. Liverpool, who have a manager who doesn't know how to win a cup. Every time he gets to a final, he loses pretty much most of them. Chelsea, who sack a manager every 2 years. Pep hasn't got anything to compete with. And on top of that, he's had stupid amounts of money. Would Pep, right now, if you said to him, look, you're going into Man City, when he did, but when you go in there, you've got to bring through, say, 6 or 7 youth team players and go on and win the Premier League title with them. Could he do it? I don't think he could. Man United under Alex Ferguson, okay? They brought through Beckham, Nicky Butt, Paul Scholes, Gary Neville, Phil Neville. He'd brought through, obviously, Beckham earlier than that. That's 5 straight away. But Scholes, Beckham, the 2 Nevilles. He tried to bring through Chris Casper at the same time. Keith Gillespie, Thornton. What the hell's his name? Ben Thornley, who picked up an horrible injury and didn't make it. He had to retire at a really young age, which is a shame for the lad. There were so many players. Later on, Darren Fletcher, Marcus Rashford. He was given his chance under Fergie, was it? Or was it David Moyes, I think, sorry. Let's have a quick look, because I know I'm forgetting people here. Okay, I have a list of the youth players that came through under Fergie from the 90s onwards. Okay. David Beckham, one of the best England players ever. And he was down to Fergie. Nicky Butt didn't have a bad career at United whatsoever. Went on to Newcastle. Chris Casper, I remember Casper as a young lad. Didn't really make it. Terry Cook, not really. Simon Davies, he had a good career. He went down, he left United. I think he went to Peterborough, I think so. Made his way to Tottenham in the end. Had a good little few years there. Went on to Portsmouth, I think it was. Did alright for himself. Keith Gillespie, unfortunately, had a bit of a gambling habit. I've read his book. He got himself into a bit of a mess. Ended up at Newcastle as part of the Andy Cole deal. Had a good time at Newcastle. Gary Neville, best right back, English right back I've ever seen. Phil Neville, didn't do too bad at all. Could have an odd mistake in him, but had a great career at Everton after leaving Man United. Colin McGee, not really. Pat McGibbon, no. John O'Kane, he didn't do too bad. I can't remember where he went on to, but he left us at a young age. Kevin Pilkington was a goalkeeper who most goals. Probably the best passing midfielder in my lifetime. Especially English. George Switzer. Couldn't tell you much about him. Ben Formley picked up a horrible injury and retired early. Wes Brown had a great career at United before moving on to Sunderland. And Robbie Savage didn't make it at United, but Blackburn, Birmingham. Where else was he at? Robbie Savage. Derby County for a little bit, I think. Leicester City. He had a great career, Robbie Savage did. In the 2000s, he brought through John O'Shea and Darren Fletcher. Both had great careers with United. And then there's loads that he tried to bring through that just didn't work. Giuseppe Rossi, he resigned at a young age, just didn't work, but he went to have a great career in Spain and Italy, and a fair few others. There have been a few that didn't work out. Ravel Morrison was one of Fergie's biggest regrets that he couldn't get it out of him, but look at how his career's gone since. Paul Pogba was just being a bit of a dick back then under Fergie. How many players in 3 years has Pep Guardiola brought through? Nope. Zinchenko. You know, they brought him in. They didn't bring him through the youth academy. And they're happy to let him go now. Phil Foden hardly ever gets a game. They signed a lad from Fulham back for 2 years ago. The season Guardiola took over. Patrick Roberts. They sent him on loan to Celtic. I mean, he was in the first team at Fulham doing great. He'd still be there now in the Premier League at Fulham. Instead, they sent him to Celtic. He had a great season. Celtic ordered him again. I think they got him for a little bit longer. And then, this season, Man City sent him to Girona in Spain, where that's like City's parent, sister club. They own Girona as well as Man City. So they sent Patrick Roberts there. I read the other day it wasn't going very well for Patrick Roberts, and Girona were looking at ending the deal. Well, hang on, this young lad would be in the Premier League with Fulham now, playing very well, ahead of, in front of Ryan Sessegnon or whatever, with Sessegnon at left back, Patrick Roberts on the left wing, but no, he's nowhere near the team. So don't be telling me Pep Guardiola will be better than Fergie in a couple of years' time if he wins more Premier Leagues. Fergie won the treble with kids that he brought through. Half of our team was young kids. They brought through Giggs, Scholes, Beckham, Gary Neville, Nicky Butt on the bench, Phil Neville on the bench. That's six players straight away there. And they go on. Wes Brown used to be in that team at the same time, so I was like seven. On any given day, he'd be in that team with those players. And we're here. Oh, Pep Guardiola is the best ever. No, he's not. It really not. Our team was mainly British back then. You know, it'd be Mark Hughes, Brian McClare, Brian Robson, Steve Bruce, Gary Pallister, Paul Parker, Dennis Irwin, Roy Keane. We was a solely pretty much British club. When I was a little kid, with the most foreigners we had in there was Eric Cantona, Andre Kanchelskis, Peter Schmeichel. I think that was about it. Off the top of my head, you was only allowed like three or four foreigners in your team at a time back then. So we're going to get into the whole point behind this is youth players and how many clubs are actually bringing through youth players. And I've got the list here. All Premier League teams, this was done back in, let's have a look when this was done, August of this year. So a few months ago, just after the start of the season, we're going to go through which clubs are bringing through Premier League youth players through in their Premier League teams. And the list is shocking. It is really shocking. Believe it or not, Man City ain't the worst, but they're also not one of the best either. You want to claim to be the best team in the Premier League and this top club, and you're doing great things for English football and for the Premier League. Show me that you're doing great things for it. Bring through players that can help my country. If you're not, then you're not doing anything good. Let's have a look. With one player in their teams so far this season, this was back in August, we had Bournemouth, Burnley, Watford and Cardiff. Bournemouth's only youth player to be in their team was Jack Simpson. He was a graduate from Bournemouth. performance under 18 side. He joined the first team squad in January of this year. The centre back is yet to establish himself, making just a single Premier League appearance with two EFL Cup starts and an FA Cup outing. Of all the teams in England's top flight, Bournemouth's youth graduates have the lowest, have the joint lowest number of appearances. Again, Eddie Howe. Everyone banks on Eddie Howe is great with young English players or bring through British players. But hang on, you don't bring through any kids. So you're not doing anything good, are you? So sod Eddie Howe for England. He doesn't believe in youth, England's youth. Otherwise he'd bring him through. Instead he goes out and signs David Brooks, who's done well. But he's not one of the academy graduates. At Burnley, we have Aidan O'Neill, who has played in three Premier League matches. He came through the under-18s at Burnley. He's Australian-born, but he spent the last couple of seasons on loan in England's English lower divisions. However, he earned his place in the Burnley first team squad in January and remains part of the 25-man list for this season. At Watford, you have Adrian Mariapa, who has made 54 appearances but came through the Watford youth team. At the age of 31, he has played for both Reading and Palace since graduating as a Watford youth player. This season, he is the only Watford first team player who's come through their academy. That's shocking. And at Cardiff, we have Joe Rawls, or Rowles. Having just come up from the Championship, it is perhaps not that surprising that Cardiff is opting for established players rather than academy graduates. I can get that with Cardiff, I can. Let's get on to the next page. Bear with me, guys. This thing takes a while to load up. Page 2. With two players in their team, we have Huddersfield Town and Brighton and Hove Albion. Huddersfield have Ryan Schofield and Philip Billing. They've made a combined total appearances of 17. They have two Youth Academy graduates in their squad. The 18-year-old keeper Ryan Schofield is yet to make a first-team appearance for the Terriers, and Philip Billing has played 16 times last season and started their opening game this season against Chelsea. Brighton have Sully March and Lewis Dunk. They have both become regulars in the Brighton first team since graduating from the academy. March has played 37 times on the left side of midfield for the Seasiders, while Dunk has made 39 appearances at the heart of the Brighton defence. Both players started Brighton's opening game against Watford this season. On the next page is ones with three players in their team. Let's have a look. This is just shocking now. This should be made to have Premier League, to have youth players in their Premier League squads. It's ridiculous. Teams with three players. Now here we go. Two of these teams are hoping to win a Premier League title this season, and yet they've only got three youth players in their youth graduates in their team. We have Newcastle United, Man City, Leicester City, and Liverpool. At Newcastle, you have Freddie Woodman, Rolando Ahrens, and Paul Dummett. Of the three academy products in Newcastle's first team squad, Paul Dummett is by far the most experienced. The left back graduated from the under 18 team before going on loan for a couple of seasons between 2012 and 2013. However, he established himself as a first team player for the Magpies in 2013 and has made 87 Premier League appearances. In that time, Man City have Phil Foden, Brahim Diaz, and Jason Denier, who I thought was on loan at Celtic. Maybe I'm wrong. They have 10 appearances in the Premier League between the three of them. Really? Pep, you're going to be better than Fergie in 3 years' time? No. You can buy titles. You can say Fergie bought titles by signing Rio and signing Rooney and Ronaldo. But hang on. Ronaldo was a kid when we signed him. He wasn't like he was when he left us. Rooney was a kid when he signed for us. We weren't going out and signing David Silvers and Agüero's and companies, bloody Riyad Mahrez, you know, Edison. Oh, we had a good keeper, can't get that wrong. And we did sign some big players. I'm not gonna sugarcoat it. players. Beckham became the greatest right side midfielder at that time on was playing for us. Scholes, Nicky Butt, Gary Neville, Ryan Giggs. The list goes on and on. Man City, for a club which has invested millions into their youth setup over the past few years, Man City can be disappointed with the number of academy products in their first team squad. The three players have combined 10 appearances in the Premier League to date. This is in August. Ranking as the sixth lowest number of appearances for academy graduates of all Premier League clubs, this clearly shows that City's priorities do not currently lie with developing youth talent. Disgusting. Now, come at me. Anybody come at me and say, Pep's better than Fergie. Balls, is he? Balls. You owe it to your club. People can say, look what Man City are doing for the area. They're helping out with schools, with hospitals, all that. Great, well done. What would a City fan love more than anything at the end of this season? A Man City fan, I can guarantee, would love to see a youth player, whether it be Phil Foden or a couple of youth players, holding the Premier League trophy up above their head, like Chelsea had when they would see John Terry lifted up. Man City don't have that. You can go and sign Raheem Sterling and claim he's one of yours and John Stones. They're not. John Stones was at Barnsley before going to Everton, before going to Man City. Raheem Sterling was at, I read this a while back, QPR, before going to Liverpool. The story of Raheem Sterling. He was playing like an under-10s game or something silly like that. And the referee, I think, was this Jack Wilshere. One of the other, I read it in my book. A scout was there anyway, watching Raheem Sterling, I think it was, and he calls up his mate and says, you got to get down here and watch this lad, he's fantastic. Someone goes down from Liverpool, taps him up, there you go. Jack Wilshere was playing in a game and the referee was a scout for Arsenal. It was like an under-10s game. And Jack Wilshere was playing for a lower league youth team. And Wickham Wanderers, I think it was. I'm sure he was playing for Wickham. I might be wrong. The referee's watching him, rings up his mate from Arsenal, says, get down here and sign this lad right now. That was a referee tapping up Jack... Sorry, guys. Tapping up Jack Wilshere. It's crazy. So Leicester City have Hamza, Chudery, Ben Chilwell and Andy King, who have 7 Premier League goals and 128 appearances between them. We have a major success story from Leicester's youth setup is their midfielder Andy King. Having moved at youth level from Chelsea, King played for Leicester's under-18s before establishing himself as a regular first team player. Liverpool, Connor Randall. I've never heard of him really play in the Premier League. Ojo, he's always out on loan. And Trent Alexander-Arnold. 38 appearances between them. Of the academy graduates, Trent Alexander-Arnold stands out as the major success, still only 19. The defender was a member of England's World Cup squad over the summer and has established himself as a first-choice right-back at Anfield. I can't argue about Alexander-Arnold. He's done great for Liverpool, but the other two, never heard him playing, really. Shay Ojo was at Wolves a couple of seasons ago on loan. We then have 4 players. We have West Ham, Fulham, Arsenal and Chelsea. At West Ham, we have Josh Cullen, Reece Oxford, Declan Rice and Mark Noble with 359 appearances between them and 37 goals. Obviously, Noble takes up most of those. West Ham traditionally boast a wonderful youth system and have produced numerous great players over the years. This season squad features 4 products of their youth academy with Mark Noble the standout name. Reece Oxford and Declan Rice are also names that may merit a mention, both aged 19. Fulham have Luca Della Torre, Marcus Bettinelli, Ryan Sessegnon and Corley Woodrow with 7 Premier League appearances between them when this was done. Fulham are back in the big time and bring with them one of the most exciting youth players in Europe at the moment. Ryan Sessegnon has earned plaudits from all corners Palace following his outstanding season in the Championship. However, we can expect big things from the midfield in the future, and it will be hugely surprising if Fulham don't cash in on their player next year. Of the other names, Corley Woodrow is worth a mention. He is a survivor from Fulham's previous stint in the Premier League. Yep, and also Bettinelli, who is their first choice keeper. Arsenal. This is an interesting one. Arsenal have Emiliano Martinez, nowhere near the team. Ainsley Maitland-Niles, I think he's gone out on loan this season, I'm sure he has. Alex Iwobi and Hector Bellerin, having moved from Barcelona's youth team to Arsenal's under-18s in 2011, Bellerin is counted as an academy product. The Spanish right-back is among the best in the world. It is trade debatable, and has made over 125 appearances. Of the other players, Alex Iwobi is an exciting prospect who is yet to fulfil his potential. He's made 65 appearances in the league for Arsenal, but there is still a feeling that more is to come from the 22-year-old. At Chelsea, we have Charlie Musonda. He's never going to get in that team. He's always out on loan. Andreas Christensen, nowhere near the team under Sarri. And under Conte, he lost his place late on last season. Been talking of a move lately. Tammy Abraham, out on loan at Villa. And Ruben Loftus-Cheek is behind Ross Barkley. So you had Loftus-Cheek already there. You can't sign Ross Barkley. And Loftus-Cheek ends up pushed further down the list. With five players in the team from the Youth Academy, we have Crystal Palace, Man United, Tottenham Hotspur and Wolves. At Palace we have Ryan Innes, never heard of him. Salih Kaikai, I've heard of him. Aaron Wan-Bissaka, he's done great this season. I watched him against Tottenham the other day. Jonathan Williams and Wilfred Zaha. Palace have always boasted a very good youth setup, and he's currently reaping the rewards of that effort. By far the standout player from their academy in recent years is Wilfred Zaha. At Man United, we have, see, this ain't bad. Listen to this list, okay? I want you to listen to this and then wind back to when I mentioned Man City's. So Man City had Brahim Diaz, yeah, Phil Foden and Jason Denayer, who from what I know is on loan at Celtic again this season. Diaz only plays a couple of cup games and Foden's no near the team. Listen to this. Man United's team, youth players in our team. Andres Pereira, who's now a first team regular. He had a lot of loan spells. He's now in the first team quite regular. Scott McTominay, who Mourinho brought through last season, played countless games last season. Not as many this season, but he's still in and around the team. Paul Pogba, who we brought back, is now a first team regular. Week in, week out. Marcus Rashford plays pretty much every game under Mourinho. And Jesse Lingard, who had a great season last season, and is a first team, first 11 regular. So that's 1, 2, 3, 5 players right there who are on any given day. You would find our up front, we'd have Rashford. In midfield, he's played Pogba and McTominay last season with Lingard. And then every once in a while, this season, he'd play Pereira rather than Pogba or whatever. So all five of those are regular players in our first team. Can't say the same about City. Even now, we're trying to do things the right way. Not at Man City though. We can go out and sign Lukaku, Lindelof, Eric Bailly, bloody Pogba, Alexis Sanchez. But our team will always have a sprinkling of our youth products in there every week without fail. I think there's a stupid stat that it's been like 20 odd years or something like that, maybe more, since United put our team without a youth academy player in there. No other team can boast that, I don't think. Tottenham have Cameron Carter-Vickers, Kyle Walker-Peters, Josh Onnemar, Harry Winks and Harry Kane. Harry Kane, every week. Harry Winks, pretty much, quite often now he's back to fitness. Walker-Peters is a right back, and it's just because Trippier and Aurier are there, but he still plays a fair few games. Carter Vickers, I think, is out on loan. I might be wrong. And Josh runaway is doing very well at Aston Villa on loan. At Wolves, we have Connor Ronan, Dominic Iofa, Bright, Enabakare, Ebanks Blake, Johnny Bart, Danny Bart, who's the club captain, Morgan Gibbs-White, who I've seen a couple of times recently, played against Arsenal yesterday, and nearly scored, I think he hit the post late on in that game. He was playing the other day against Tottenham. He was playing passes that the pundits were raving about. I heard somebody say they've not seen passes like that from an English player in years, and that was this young lad, Morgan Gibbs-White. So he sounds like he's one for, definitely for the future for Wolves. Because players like Ruben Neves, if he finds his form again, won't stick around for much longer. Maybe another season, then they'll be on the way. Youth players like Morgan Gibbs-White stick around because they're faithful to their clubs a lot of the time. So Wolves, who are a newly promoted team, have 6 youth academy players in their 25-man squad. That is ridiculous. A team that are relying on staying up, and they can have 6 players in there. Maybe one or two of them are out on loan, but they were included in the squad at the beginning of the season. Man United have 6 players. Or is it 6? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so 1, 2, yeah, 5. Wolves had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And now we go up to teams with 7 players. And there are 2 teams with 7 youth academy players in their team. They are Everton and Southampton. As much as I knock Southampton, you have to say they bring through players. Nathaniel Klein, Matt Target. Who else they brought through? Schneiderlin, who's a young player there, before he went to Man United. Oxlade-Chamberlain, Theo Walcott. There's been loads, hasn't there? I mean, these obvious ones I'm just not thinking of right this second. They've brought through a lot of players though, Southampton have. At Everton, we have Matthias Huell, Kieran Dowell, Matthew Pennington, Tyus Browning, Benny Bangime, John Joe Kenny, and Tom Davies. Tom Davies and John Joe Kenny are the ones that stand out to me, who've made a lot of appearances in the last couple of seasons. Kieran Dowell, I've heard of. Tyus Browning, I've heard of. Pennington, I think so. Huell and Bangime, not heard of them too. Of all the players, only Tom Davies has a real opportunity to play consistently over the season. The 20-year-old has shown flashes of brilliance during his 59 appearances so far, and he'll be hoping to really kick on this season to establish himself as an important player for the club. At Southampton, we have Josh Sims, Harrison Reed, Sam Gallagher, Sam McQueen, Matt Target, Jack Stevens, James Ward-Prowse, there's another one, and Jack Stevens, who did very well in the FA Cup final I saw against Man United, Carling Cup final, a couple of years ago. Over the past few seasons, Southampton has produced player after player from the youth academy. The only problem for the Saints is that they keep moving on to bigger clubs. Yeah, they do, to be fair. Liverpool have enjoyed Southampton's production line over the last few years. Now, the whole point of that little feature was what I said at the beginning. I get sick and tired of people banging about how good Pep Guardiola is. Let's go through, okay? At Barcelona, he didn't bring through Messi. He didn't bring through Busquets, Iniesta, Xavi, Piqué, Puyol. He didn't. They were already there. Piqué, he might have signed him. I don't know who signed him from Man United. But he was already... I think he was already coming by... what's his name? Rijkaard. Frank Rijkaard, I think, brought in Piqué. He brought through Xavi, Iniesta, Busquets, Messi, Puyol, Valdez. All Pep did was go in there and continue the production line. He just continued letting these great players come through. I'd love to see how many. Let's have a little look. I want to pause this and come back to you one moment. Here we go. expected to bring youth to players through at Bayern Munich. They're not. So he didn't. He only brought through a couple of players at Bayern Munich. I don't know enough about Bayern to comment on that. But I have the list here. This list was done about a month or so ago. This is a list of the players Pep Guardiola brought through at Barcelona during his time. He brought through 13 players. And let's see how well they've actually got on to do. He brought through Rafinha, who is still there now. He's regular in the Barcelona team. Would we say Rafinha is a world-class player? Would you say he would be top of a list of players for a Premier League club to sign? No. I think it's just one of Barcelona's sort of average players. He brought through Sergio Roberto, who is their right back. He got the big success from Guardiola's final stand as being Barca's first choice right back for some time, but could be used in his preferred midfield role more often next season. Sergio Roberto is an alright player, but he's not ahead in terms of the best right backs in the world or whatever, is he? He's not up there with it in the top five, top six. Gerard Deulofeu was a player brought through. He's now at Watford. Mark Muniesa is, where's he at now? Oh, that was it. He ended up at Stoke, where he made just two appearances for Stoke. This is a player that Pep brought through. He only got two appearances at Stoke. They loaned him out in January to Girona, and he's now made the move permanent. Mark Bartra, who ended up at Borussia Dortmund before moving to Real Betis in January. Martin Montoya, who went on to make 45 appearances for Barcelona, but was never really good enough. Went on loan to Inter before signing for Valencia in 2016. Christian Tello, an exciting winger full of pace, perfect for Barca, right? Sadly not. Never really got to grips with tiki-taka. He's now at Betis with former La Masia colleague Bartra. You got Oya, who was Victor Valdez and Pinto's third choice. He's now at Levante in the second division. Oh no, he's now second choice at Levante, sorry. Jonathan De Santos. Just like his brother Schiavone, De Santos never fulfilled his potential. A handful of senior appearances for Barca wasn't enough for the club to keep him. He went to Villarreal in 2014. Ruben Mino, a goalkeeper who struggled. He's now at Albacete. Sergi Gomez. He never got a game. But after leaving Barca, he went on to make a name for himself at Celta Vigo. He's now at Sevilla. Kiko Femenia. He went on to Real Madrid's B team. He's now at Watford. And Marty Rivarola, saving the worst for last, sadly, never made the cut at Barcelona and opted to try his luck in Italy with Bologna and then Foggia. He's now at Reggiana in Serie C. Ouch. Does that not tell you everything you need to know? I'm so happy I found that list. I really am. Maybe I sound like a bitter Man United fan. I don't give a crap. I don't. Pep Guardiola is claimed to be amazing. Fergie brought through 6 or 7 first teamers that went on to have amazing success with Man United. Win trebles, win Premier Leagues, Champions Leagues, the lot. Pep Guardiola couldn't bring through 2 decent players. Out of 13 that he tried to bring through, 11 of them are definite failures. Rafinha and Roberto were their only possible successes. He had Messi, he had Xavi, he had Iniesta, he had Piqué, he had Puyol, he had Busquets. How can you fail with them players? He didn't fail. He had great success. But there's a reason he's not won a Champions League since leaving Barcelona. It's easy to win when you have money. It's easy to win when you have that group of players. Fergie never had that group of players. He brought through that group of players. Scholes, the Nevilles, Ryan Giggs, David Beckham, Nicky Butt, So enough of this crap. Pep is the king of kings and the god of everyone. Balls, is he? I'd like to see him do it with bloody Chesterfield or Darlington or Newport County or Morecambe. My old team, where I'm from. I paid struggle then. Right, guys, let's get on to the results from the weekend. I think I've had my rant for today. Let's have a look at the results. So, yes, Saturday, Cardiff beat Brighton. Way, I did predict Cardiff win, I'm sure I did. Cardiff got the victory 2-1. Karl Patterson's like third goal in 3 or 4 games, I think. Sol Bamber in the 90th minute, Lewis Dunk in the 6th minute for Brighton. Dale Stevens sent off in the 34th minute. Huddersfield Town 1, West Ham 1. Not a bad result for Huddersfield. I know they were leading, but it's still not a loss. That's a good result. Alex Pritchard for Huddersfield and Felipe Anderson again for West Ham. Leicester City 0, Burnley 0. A great result for Burnley. Away at Leicester to get a goalless draw on an emotional day. Great result for Burnley. Personally, and it's going to sound controversial, but I feel Leicester need to let this go with their owner. I sound terrible, I know I do. I don't mean it in a disrespectful way. What good is it doing, dragging it on? What good is it doing them? I heard the other day that if they scored, they wouldn't celebrate. Or they wouldn't play some music or something or other. Do you honestly think their owner, or previous owner, wouldn't want them to be happy? Wouldn't want them to celebrate and enjoy the moment of scoring a goal? Of course he would. They need to move on now. And enjoy the rest of the season for the sake in his memory. So a good result for Burnley, 0-0. Newcastle with a victory against Bournemouth. I'm pretty certain I predicted it. I don't go back and watch my videos, I'm sure I predicted a Newcastle win. Solomon Rondon, 2 goals, 7th and 40th minute. Jefferson Lerma for Bournemouth, got one back. Southampton 1, Watford 1. Is Mark Hughes officially the worst manager ever? I mean, ever. Look at the run he's on at the minute. Now winning like 400 games or something for Southampton. He's terrible. Goal for Manuel Gabbiadini and equaliser for Honabas for Watford. Afterwards, Charlie Austin had a bit of a bitch and a moan about the referee. Palace 0, Tottenham 1. Palace without Zaha. Tottenham without Eric Dier. I think Ericsson was out. They had no Vertonghen. No, Davinson Sanchez. Trippier got injured early on. A really good result for Tottenham. One Foyth. I think it's one. Anyway, Foyth, the young lad, who gave away 2 penalties last week against Wolves. He was in again yesterday. Would have been easy to rest him, but he was in there. And we got a 1-0 win. He scored the goal. Well done to the lad. A great result for Tottenham. Sunday in the Premier League. Liverpool 2, Fulham 0, Mo Salah, Jordan Shaqiri, routine win for Liverpool. Fulham, is he going to go, Jokanovic? I reckon he is now. Chelsea 0, Everton 0, what a shock result this was. I expected a Chelsea victory. Arsenal 1, Wolves 1, come on Wolves, Wolves ain't we? Henrik Mkhitaryan in the 86th minute, after Ivan Cavallero put Wolves ahead in the 13th. And Wolves did well to keep clean sheet for the best part of like 70 odd minutes. Man City 3, Man United 1. David Silva, Sergio Aguero, Ilkay Gundogan and Anthony Martial for Man United with a penalty. Martial's in great form. I don't care if it's only a penalty, great form. The results, what can I say? I'm a surprised now. I think the result midweek against Juve was a good performance. It wasn't just a good result. It was a good performance by United. City are on a different level. I cannot knock Pep for what he's done there. I just think it's wrong to call to say he's better than Fergie when he don't bring through youth players. I watched the game. It was on in the background whilst I had my dinner and whatnot. And I was not surprised. I had it on pause. And then I pressed play. It was 1-0. So for fuck's sake. And then I pause it to go and fit to make the dinner. Come back in, press watch MasterChef or some shit. No, no, I'll leave it on pause for you. I wish she hadn't done. It was just on in the background. I really had no interest in watching the bloody match once we were 1-0 down. We were playing absolutely redonkulously bad, like horribly, embarrassingly bad. And it just pissed me off. As a United fan, I get so fed up watching us play, so, like, so amateurish. I can't sit there and enjoy a match if we're playing that bad. Josh Edwards, who's a subscriber, are you going to make a video about the Manchester derby? I went to it yesterday and loved it. Yeah, cheers, Josh. I'm assuming you're a City fan, you bugger. Well done, lad. Fair play to you. You should enjoy it. But I didn't. I don't enjoy watching my club anymore. And not many people can say that. And it's a sad day when you can say, I don't enjoy watching my club play football anymore. But going back to Martial, he's in good form. Well done to the lad. I'm thinking of doing my hair Aguero style. Why not? That'd be a bit shocking on here, wouldn't it? It'd match my microphone. Maybe I'll do it. Maybe I won't. We'll see. Hang on, I need a drink. Too much talking. In the championship. Sheffield Wednesday, goalless draw. On Saturday we had Bolton lose again to Swansea 1-0, Birmingham 3, Hull City 3, Blackburn 1, Rotherham 1, Bristol 0, Preston 1, Derby 0, Villa 3. Frankie Lampard losing out to his old mate John Terry. Middlesbrough 2, Wigan 0, Norwich 4, Millwall 3. Wow. Forest 0, Stoke 0, QPR 3, Brentford 2. Brentford lose again under their new manager. Reading 2, Ipswich 2, West Brom 4, Leeds United 1. That is shocking. I mean, Leeds were top of the league going to that game. Hal Robson-Carney, Matty Phillips, Harvey Barnes and Dwight Gale for West Brom. Pablo Hernandez with a late goal for Leeds United to get one goal back. On Sunday, there was no championship games. The Premier League table, City first, Liverpool second, Chelsea third, Spurs fourth, Arsenal, Bournemouth, Watford, United make up the top eight. Everton in ninth, Leicester 10th, Wolves 11th, 12th, Brighton 13th, West Ham 14th, Newcastle 15th, Burnley 16th, Palace 17th, Southampton 18th, Cardiff 19th, Huddersfield and 20th, Fulham. I really think the bottom five teams will get cut away. I reckon so. Fulham, Huddersfield, I know Cardiff won, Southampton, Palace and Burnley. I think they could be the bottom five come the end of the season. I think Newcastle might get a bit of confidence now and get a few wins. But do not be surprised to see if Cardiff get themselves a couple of victories over the next 5-6 games. Championship, league table, top six, Norwich in top place, Middlesbrough, Leeds United, Sheffield United, West Brom and Derby County. Bottom four, Millwall, Hull, Bolton and Ipswich are bottom. They have 5 points adrift at the bottom of Ipswich. Not looking good for them at all right now. Who's their new manager right now? They sacked their manager, didn't they? Oh, what's his name? Paul Lambert. Yeah, they're definitely going down with him in charge. Right, around the world in 40 seconds. That's what we should call this feature. So in Spain, we had Atletico Bilbao 3-2. Thomas. Who's Thomas? I don't even bloody know. Hernandez. And Godin for Atletico. Izzy, something like that. Williams with 2 goals for Bilbao. In Germany, we had Nuremberg lost, gutted. Bayern Munich lost 3-2 to Dortmund. Wow, I did see this result the other day. Marco Reus with 2 goals. And Paco Alcacer, Lewandowski with 2 for Bayern Munich. In Italy, we had Parma beat Torino 2-1. Well done. Come on, Parma. The old Arsenal player, Trevino, with a goal. And Inglesi. Napoli beat Genoa 2-1. Ruiz Peña and Barashi on goal for Napoli. In Holland, PSV beat Graschap 4-1. Luc de Jong with another 2 goals. In France, Lyon beat Greencamp 4-2. Memphis Depay is in great form. Couldn't do for United. Loving life in France by the looks of it. On Sunday in Europe, in Spain, Real Madrid, sorry, Barcelona 3, Real Betis 4. Wow. Lionel Messi. Let's go through this. Okay, so Firpo Adames put Betis 1 up. Joaquin, is he still playing? Wow. Joaquin put him 2-0 up. Lo Celso put them 3-0 up. No, sorry, it was 2-0. Then Messi got a penalty, 2-1. Then Lo Celso, 3-1. And then Alex Vidal made it 3-2 to Real Betis by scoring for Barcelona. And then Canales scored for Betis, making 4-2. Messi got one in the 92nd minute to make it 4-3. And Rakitic was sent off in the 81st minute. What a crazy game. Real Madrid won 4-2 away at Celta. Benzema, Cabral on goal, Sergio Ramos penalty, and Dani Ceballos for Real Madrid. I reckon they'll stick with the man who's in charge now. What's his name? I can't remember. The one who used to play for him. I reckon Solari. I reckon he stays in charge till the end of the season. And then maybe Wenger goes in. Don't be surprised to see that happen. In Germany, Leipzig 3, Leverkusen 0. Schalke 3-0 to Frankfurt. In Italy, Inter lost 4-1 away at Atalanta. What a shock result that is. 4-1 away. Mauro Icardi with the only goal for Inter. Brozovic sent off. Roma beat Sampdoria 4-1. Juan Jesus, Schick, and 2 for El Shaarawy. Lazio 1-1 away at Sassuolo. And AC Milan 0. Juve 2. One for Mandzukic, one for Ronaldo. Higuain missed a penalty and he was sent off against his old team. In Holland, 7-1 Ajax beat Excelsior away. Van der Beek with 2, Schoner with 1, Dahlberg with 1. That's Kasper Dahlberg. Schouten with an own goal, Ziyech with a goal, and Campos with a goal for Ajax. In France, Henry's managerial stint goes from bad to worse. A 4-0 loss to PSG at home. Hat-trick for Cavani. One for Neymar. A penalty for Neymar. Monaco are embarrassed again. Horrible. It really is. I don't mind Thierry Henry. I quite like the bloke as a pundit. But things are going horribly wrong for the bloke right now. Our fantasy dream teams and take a look at the league table. I don't know how well I did this weekend or how bad. I haven't checked yet. I've got Aguero and he scored, so that's kind of helped me a little bit. Let's have a look. So I have 540 points. I did quite well. Wow, I got 58 points this weekend. Happy days, woohoo. So I have Wilson. Let's go from back to front. Edison, it's in goal. He got no points for me. Alonso in defence, 8 points. Robertson at Liverpool got me 15. He must have got an assist, I'm guessing. Van Dijk is in my team. He got me 8 points. Arnaud Fitch's in there, 0. Bernardo Silva, 11 points he got me. Happy days. Hazard is in my team. He got me 8 points. Richarlison's in there, 0. Aubameyang is in there, 0. Wilson 0 and Aguero 8 points. So 15 for Robertson, 11 for Silva, 8 for Alonso, 8 for Hazard, 8 for Van Dijk and 8 for Aguero. Just think, if I'd got some points from Edison, if Buddy Martial had scored the penalty, he might as well not have done for my sake. So Edison would have got me a clean sheet. Richarlison if he'd got a goal or played well. And now Switch if he'd scored. Aubameyang, Wilson. I mean, I'd have put money on Wilson and Aubameyang getting some goals over the down out of each. I could be on like 80, 90 points now, you buggers. Where are we in the Premier League, in the our league table? Let's take a look. Everyone else must have had a good week. I've only moved up one place, despite getting 58 points. That is so annoying. Wow. Everybody this weekend has had a good weekend. Pretty much everybody's had a great weekend. Bloody hell. On my Edison, he's in top spot. He has taken over from Ozil Cummidge. Well done on my Edison. He got 44 points. Let's have a look at his team. He's now moved up to top spot, so let's have a look at his squad. Edison in goal, Mendy at the back, Robertson, Sanchez, who didn't play for Tottenham. Tarkowski is injured. Take him out your team, mate. You've lost points there straight away. David, Bernardo Silva, Richarlison, Mahrez, Aguero, Salah and Kane. So he's in top spot, yet he didn't get half as many points as he could have done. Take Tarkowski out your team. So we have Edison in, on my Edison in first place, Ozil Cummidge second, Red Devils third, Barmy FC fourth, Haylock FC fifth, Unbelievable 11, 6th, Slippery FC 7th, Aspall 2000 8th, The Wee Boys 11, 9, Woodward out 10, Crouches, Slanky 11, Ra in 12th, Toby Mullis 13th, Kobe's 11, 14th, Salty Balls FC 15th, You Better Check Yourself 16th, Dyslexia U Tined at 17th, 18th is Lenner Z, 19th Raycott, YM Dream Team 20th, Wolves AOE 21st, I'm in 22nd, FCFR in 23rd, 50 Shades of O'Shea 24th, No You in 25th, JH Wanderers in 26th, All the Small in 27th, Kaya in 28th, Tears FC 29th, Salah Dodgers 30th, Uno in 31st, Mon the Boys in 32nd, Carries is God in 33rd, and Kev Clock in 34th in the table. But look at that, I mean, it's really tight now. 685 on my Edison. I'm down in 22nd on 540, so I'm a bit behind by 140 odd points. But at the top, I'd say the top 4, Haylock FC, Barmy, top 5, Haylock FC, Barmy FC, Red Devils 789, Ozil Cummidge, and on my Edison, there is only like 41 points separating them from top 5. So it's really tight all the way down. I am in 22nd, yet I'm only like 21 points off of 17th place. So it's really tight in that middle to top section. Kev, you need to get some points, mate. He's down at the bottom. He's 24 points, but he didn't start when everyone else started, to be fair to him. Hopefully he can pick up some points over the next week or two and move on up the table. And that's it. That's the video done. I am done. I am knackered. I feel as exhausted as Pep Guardiola's checkbook at Man City. Have a great day. Thumbs up. I hope you enjoyed the video. Comment below. Subscribe. Thumbs up. Enjoy. See you tomorrow with something different. Bye bye guys. See you later.